Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Social media has been abuzz with the term Brahmanical patriarchy, and it took a Twitter controversy to shift attention to it. To discuss what it really means today, we have with us Uma Chakravarti to shed light more on the aspects of what it really means. And thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us and discussing this issue with us. Interestingly, it took a Twitter controversy to talk about this term, and everybody since then has been wondering what it really means. So what is your take on it?
Well, you know, actually, the Brahmanical patriarchy has been in circulation. And interestingly, it's been in circulation amongst women's studies scholars and amongst Dalit students in particular. So it circulated in certain categories, but nobody paid too much attention to that because that's a constituency which doesn't make its mark necessarily in the media in a certain kind of way. And to that extent, there is a prehistory to the Twitter controversy. Yeah. If you look at it, it's a bunch of Dalit women in, and we have to see that the controversy comes back to us from America, yes, not from here. And it's a bunch of Dalit women who stand with that poster and hand it to the CEO of Twitter, saying smash Brahmanical patriarchy. And that has to come to us in these parts, and it's raging here. But nobody paid any attention to the fact that it was circulating among certain sections particularly. So yes, I think it's interesting that we, even our controversies come to us from mediated by America. Right, yes, right.
And only then have we actually paid attention to it. So Brahmanical patriarchy is something that people are trying to get their head around. Of course, that it's all around us, but it took us this particular instance for us to discuss what it really means. Mm-hmm. So if you could break it down for our viewers as to what is really Brahmanical patriarchy and where can we see its manifestations around us?
Yeah. Well, I'd go back to the, you know, why is it that this was a paper that was published in 1993. It was something that I'd been thinking about. I'd been thinking about caste and gender together, but I'd been particularly thinking about it since the 1990, the Mandal agitation. Those of you who have been around here would know that the Mandal agitation is the one that raised the caste question for the first, it was meant to be around the question of reservations in the civil services. But OBC reservations, but actually and the relationship between caste and gender in a sense was known, or at least may not have been theorized. And its source is many posters that young women from the elite Delhi colleges were carrying in front of them, yeah, which said, "We don't want unemployed husbands," yeah, to the ordinance. Now, when I indicate that, why is this that there's this bunch of young women who are carrying this poster, and it's seen as something that is a radical act on their part, anti-state act on their part, what is it saying? And everybody, and that they are protesting, and they're protesting on behalf of their potential husbands. Yeah. And people laugh and say, you know, they think it's how crazy that is. That the problem with it is only that they are protesting not for themselves but for their potential husbands. But the most serious part over there is what I flagged, not in the paper on Brahmanical patriarchy but later in a piece of work that I did, is that it, who is it, why is it the ordinance only said who's going to who's going to get the jobs, okay, the OBCs, yeah, were going to open up. Where is the ordinance? Now, these young women could have married these OBC characters, yeah, just as much as anybody else. Why were they actually protesting? Is because they saw it being taken away from their potential husbands. Yeah. And I would say that VP Singh has passed only the ordinance on the jobs. Who has indicated that there was an ordinance which said women should marry, some people should marry only some others? That's an internalized ordinance that women carry around them. So the link between caste and gender was very apparent in that slogan, in that whatever. And that to me was a fundamental issue in the way in which we needed to think about the conjointness of caste and gender in Indian society. Mm-hmm. So that you reproduced caste and you reproduced gender inequality simultaneously through the same system. And it is for that reason that finally I wrote my piece on Brahmanical Patriarchy, and because I am a scholar essentially of ancient Indian history, the first formulation that I made was based on the textual traditions. It has a textual tradition and in the structures for early India, and because it takes us back, it actually shows you the enduring power of a set of ideas which made endogamy the pivot of the reproduction of caste, but also the reproduction of inequality among men and women and among women and women, because that's the structure that came into being.
You know, talking more in terms of how it manifests itself around us and how sometimes we ignore those kind of intersections. So multiple systems around us are intersectional. There's a nature of intersectional oppression that you've pointed out very correctly. So if you could discuss more about those that we see around ourselves, that we see in cases around us in terms of honor killings and other.
Yeah, well, actually, that's a good opening issue. If you look at it, and then I went on after this 1993 article, in 2003 or 4, I published a book which was called Gendering Caste Through a Feminist Lens, where the full discussion of this issue was explored. And one of the things that is striking is, however modern you are, never mind whether you're in the United States of America or anywhere else, when you marry, you seek to marry from within your own endogamous group. The most visible sign of that is the advertising, is advertisements. If you look at the matrimonial ads, they will actually privilege who you are. Mm-hmm. So it will say Punjabi, Khatri, something, something. They may not say only you need to apply, but the fact is that you marked your own identity, so you're only expecting responses from the same community. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you'll get an ad which will say caste no bar. It's rare. It will often come from the castes that are regarded as low in the hierarchy. Yeah. So in a sense, the reproduction of caste is being sustained through the matrimonial system, and it has no relationship to modernity. Mm-hmm. You can be absolutely modern and you can still follow it. So modernity or the ad world works very comfortably with the caste system in India. And so it's as ubiquitous as that. And I think that's... So in a sense, the endogamy, the acknowledging that endogamy is at the heart of the caste system, and marriage is a highly controlled, let's say, element in our family system and our and our society, is evident from this account that I've given you. So at the end of the day, we are reproducing the caste system. It is not at all being diluted. Now, often it will be said that the government is creating caste through the reservation. Mm. But you're not acknowledging that caste is being also reproduced through the marriage system. Violations of this are very strongly punished. And we know, as women, and especially if you blur the boundaries, so if it's an upper caste boy and a lower caste girl, that's also not good, but it will be tolerated. But if it's an upper caste woman and a lower caste man, then it's completely, it's regarded as extremely, what would you call it, violative of the social codes. Mm-hmm. And it's punished with violence. You enforce through violence, and you know how terrible it can be. Sometimes you can kill the daughter itself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's like sadaye maut suna dete hain ladkiyon ko. Or that is the structure that we're working in. So I would not like to call it honor killing. It's a wrong term. We should call it custodial killing. Yeah. Girls are in the custody of their families, and the families execute the death penalty upon them informally. And that's the structure. That's so violations of the, what you call the pratilomic relationship, which actually go back to Manu. I mean, he's the one who bars Anuloma and Pratuloma. There are two categories. Anuloma is containable. Pratiloma is what has to be completely banned. So that structure of reproducing caste is and caste inequality and gender inequality all simultaneously is being maintained even through modern times and through modern family systems.
So that brings me to another question in terms of how we trace this system back to Manu. Because a lot of activists who've come forth because of this movement have said that it is not against a community, it is not against perhaps Brahmins, it is talking about a system which has its roots in Manuvad.
No, you're that's I'm glad that some of the activists are writing back like that. And let's also take it back. Let's take it back to Ambedkar.
Yeah.
I mean, the person who really focused on endogamy as the basis of the caste system. Mm-hmm. is Ambedkar. And as Ambedkar says very clearly, he would stand against the Shastras, for sure. But he doesn't, it's not the individual Brahmin or the individual Kshatriya or the individual Banya that he would position himself against. It's the relationship of these people within the caste structure.
Yeah.
And so Brahminism is simply the ideological, let's say, basis for caste and caste inequality. So as he puts it very movingly, in my opinion, because as someone who's a constitutionalist, he said, because it stands against liberty, equality, and fraternity. That's what you're positioning yourself as.
Yeah.
So the controversy is completely nonsensical.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can belong to any community, but if you stand against that system of inequality, which reproduces both caste and gender inequality. So strictly speaking, everyone should be against should be against that system,
yeah.
That mode of everyone should be against Brahmanical patriarchy. If you're a constitutionalist, and if you stand against inequality, you must actually be against Brahmanical patriarchy because that's the source of that inequality.
And interestingly, of course, a good thing has been the discussions that have come out of this whole controversy. But again, there has been a very strong reaction coming from political fronts, coming from the BJP and the Congress alike, about how it is an attack on certain communities. So how would you react to that, that it's an attack?
It's completely nonsensical. It's not an attack on community. It's against. It's an attack on a way of thinking. And in a way of reproducing social relations. It's against the manifestation of the it's against that structure. It is not against individuals. You can belong to any community. You are any set of people.
Mm-hmm.
And it is not to say that caste is not being, let's say, endogamy is not being practiced across the board.
Yeah.
So it's not only the Brahmins who are practicing it or the dominant sections are. Endogamy is being practiced across the board, but it helps us, it helps to reproduce caste inequality. That is what we have to acknowledge, and that is what we have to stand against. And you can belong to anywhere. If you're a democratic person, you would stand against, if you're a democratic person and you're a feminist, and anyone can be a feminist,
yes.
You would stand against gender inequality and caste inequality. So you would be against Brahmanical patriarchy.
Mm-hmm.
It's as simple as that.
Now, coming to the question of smashing Brahmanical patriarchy, how do we do that in our everyday lives? If you were to give, you know, messages to young people, because we're all very charged up currently thinking about how we can end this structure of oppression together.
Mm.
So what is the key takeaway from this?
I think the key takeaway is to see, that, not to ignore, that this structure also reproduces the inequality of resources.
Yeah.
So when we talk about, and I want to take this back to critical moments in our history in which we should have ended the perpetuation of the caste system in terms of caste, class, and gender inequality, you know. So we have not actually made live resources communal or redistributed resources. Instead, the palliative of, I mean, I'll stand for reservations as long as we have nothing else.
Yeah.
But the fact is that the reservation is only a partial, it is only a way of saying you have a right to live and I'll give you a job.
Yeah.
But the fact is that everyone should have access to resources. So I think that the way to end it is that you have to work, you have to struggle, and I say this to all activists, you have to struggle against caste, class, and gender inequality simultaneously. And you should not postpone the struggle and say, pehle hum isko karenge, phir usko baad mein isko karenge. First we'll do gender, then we'll do class, and then we'll do caste. You have to actually strike at all three simultaneously because it's the same structure. It is the three joined together which have created this unequal structure. And everyone should smash it. Yeah. Everyone should smash it because it's an unequal structure. Mm-hmm. And it's, to my mind, it's a vitiation of the constitutional provisions and the constitutional spirit. So I would say that's what you have to do.
So on that note, that there are multiple oppressive systems and we can't fight them singularly, and we have to fight oppressive systems together. So we leave you with that message. Thank you for watching NewsClick. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this discussion with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.